Literally or metaphorically, اقتربت الساعة وانشق القمر. The hour is drawing near. All of our lives are dissipating. There's three sa'at according to our ulama. When we speak about the end of time, there are three ends of time. The first one is the end of your life. The first one is the end of your life. 5 minutes left? I just started. It's too depressing for people. He's like, man, we don't need to hear this. This is Minna. This isn't Isna. We're the young people. We need some hope. Keep hope alive. I'm going to get to the hopeful part. There's three sa'at. The first one is your life. Your life will come to an end. We all have terminal lives. They come to an end. The second one is a generation. Right now we're having a generation disappear. For instance, Holocaust survivors. This is a generation of people that experience something. They have tattoos on their arms, many of them. And they're living testimonies to a historical event that happened that most of us weren't alive when it happened. That generation is dying out. They'll be gone in a very short time. So there are no more eyewitnesses to that event. The World War II generation is dying out. They're gone. Just like now, there's no Confederate War veterans anymore. There's probably, I think the last World War I veteran died in England recently. So a generation will die. And then finally you have the ultimate end, which is when all of this is closed down. But we have a ways to go, and I want to emphasize this. And that's why young people, don't be bothered. But even if we didn't, the Prophet ﷺ said, if the end of time comes and you find yourself planting a seedling, if you're able to before the actual end comes, finish planting. So we never give up, because you would rather meet your Lord having planted something and done something positive than meet Him without having done that deed. We're always looking towards our Lord. We don't look necessarily at the fruits in this world, like the Khalifa, the Caliph that passed by the old man who was planting zaytuna trees. And everybody knows the olive tree takes a long time to mature till you get olives. And he said, لِمَاذَ تَزْرَعُ الزَّيْتُونَ لَا تَأْكُلُوا مِنْهَا. Why are you doing this zaytun? You're not going to eat from it. He said, زَرَعُوا فَأَكَلْنَا فَنَزْرَعُوا حَتَّى يَأْكُلُوا. They planted those before us, and we ate from what they planted, so we must plant for those who come after us. This is a vision of what we're supposed to be doing. Our lives are temporal, but we have to see that we're torchbearers. That was a topic yesterday, of passing on the torch. Just like you have there's a certain type of marathon race. If people who know track, there's a baton, and you hand the baton to the next runner. These relay races, right? I ran that in high school. And you have to learn how to get the baton and take the baton and move. And you're the next person because you have energy. That person, he's worn out. Take it, I can't take anymore. So you grab it and you carry it as far as you can. You expend all your energy and then you hand it on to the next group. This is the nature of our lives on earth. We're carrying the baton for a short time, but we have to think about handing it to the next group of people. And we have all these young people, and I like Imam Al-Qasim said something beautiful one day in Toronto. It had an effect on me. He said to the young people, if anybody tells you you're the future, say no. I'm the present. I'm the present. You have things to do right now. You have things to do right now. And you should do them to the best of your ability. But I want you to be aware, all of these tribulations and all of these calamities that are happening, don't worry. We have to struggle to make it better, to do whatever we can in our power, but don't worry. Al-aqibatu lil-muttaqeen. The end affair is for the people of taqwa. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا تَكُوا فِي ضَيْقًا مِمَّا يَمْكُرُونَ. Don't get constricted about their plots. Don't get constricted about all of the things that they're doing against you. And then he says, if you have taqwa and if you're patient, Allah is with you. If you don't have taqwa and you don't have patience, then He leaves you to yourself. So we need to practice piety. We need to practice patience. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you a complete minhaj in the Qur'an. إِنَّ الْمُسْلِمِينَ وَالْمُسْلِمَاتِ وَالْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ وَالْقَانِتِينَ وَالْقَانِتَاتِ وَالصَّادِقِينَ وَالصَّادِقَاتِ وَالصَّابِرِينَ وَالصَّابِرَاتِ وَالْخَاشِعِينَ وَالْخَاشِعَاتِ والمتصدقين والمتصدقات والصائمين والصائمات والحافظين فروجهم والحافظات والذاكرين الله كثيرا والذاكرات أعد الله لهم مغفرة وأجرا عظيما. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, those who are people in a state of submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Muslimun, they're in a state of submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But then he says, they're also in a state of tasdeeq. They're mu'mineen. It's more than just the outward forms of submission. There's an inward assent to that submission. That they believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because you can be a Muslim and be a munafiq. But the mu'min, no, this is deeper. And then the people of qunut, some of the mufassirun, they say, al-mudawimun ala ta'atillah, the people that continue to be in a state of ta'a with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They're continuous in their state. وَقُومُوا لِلَّهِ قَانِتِينَ, stand before God in a state of obedience. This is how we want to meet our Lord, in a state of obedience. And then he says, the people of truthfulness, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَكُونُوا مَعَ الصَّادِقِينَ, be with truthful people. We're a nation of sitq. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us to be shuhada. كُونُوا قَوَّامِينَ بِالْقِسْطِ شُهَدَاءَ لِلَّهِ وَلَوْ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِكُمْ أَوْ الْوَالِدَيْنِ وَالْأَقْرَبِينَ. Allah says, be people who establish justice. And then he says, be witnesses for the sake of your Lord, for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even if it means witnessing against yourselves. When you do wrong things, have the courage, have the honesty, and have the fortitude to say that this is wrong. What I did was wrong. What we did was wrong. What these Muslims did was wrong. We have to have the ability to be truthful, even witnesses against ourselves, our parents, our own relatives. This is Islam. It's a high thing. It's calling you to rise above your nafs, rise above your egos, rise above your caprice, rise above these things. Really elevate yourself. Ta'alu, atru, ma harrama rabbukum alaik. Allah says, ta'alu, which means come, but it also means elevate yourselves. It's from ulu. Come, elevate yourselves and listen to what your Lord has prohibited you to do. Because these things will elevate you. If you avoid them, you will be elevated in the world. You will be elevated. Allah will raise you up. He will raise you up as a community. But you have to be virtuous people. You have to be people of virtue. And then he says the people of sabr, wasabirin wasabirat. We have to be people of patience. There are two fundamental types of patience. You have to, as-sabru ala ta'a wa sabru ala al-ma'asiyah. Patience in doing what is right, and then patience in avoiding what is wrong. Because your nafs will be tempted. Your lower self will be tempted. So you have to avoid those. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that they're people of khushu'. This is a very important attribute. Khushu' is tawadu'. It is humility. We have to be a humble people. We have to be humble before Allah. Now I want to focus on this for one second. For more than a second. I know I'm almost out of time, but I want to focus on this. We must stop all of this arrogance and sectarianism among some of the community members that we have, who only have one way of doing things. One way. There's only one way. My way or the highway. And that's it. My way or the highway. No, we have a religion that is deeply nuanced. It has a broad usul. There are multiple interpretations for many of the rulings of Islam. And beware of arrogating to yourself the role that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to Himself alone. Allah knows His religion. Most of the ijtihadat of our great scholars were done by signing their fatwas with Wallahu a'lam. Wallahu wa rasuluhu a'lam. Allah knows best. In other words, this is the best I can do, but Allah knows best. We have to stop all of this madness where somebody says, ya akhi, haram. You can't, that's haram. Is that mujma alayh? Is it agreed upon? Have you studied these books? Have you studied the usul? Because there are some things that the ulama say, there's a difference of opinion. Some of the ulama differ on certain things. And you will have this. You will have opinions of ulama that say إن الحلال بين وإن الحرام بين وبينهما أمور مشتبهات لا يعلمهن كثير من الناس. That the halal is clear, the haram is clear, and between them are gray areas. Many people don't know them. Only the ulama are expertise in these. And we're talking about the giant ulama, not people who have studied and done their Nizami course or done their graduate from 4 years at a Islamic university. No. Some of the teachers I studied with studied for 30 years at the hands of their teachers. 30 years. And they have lifelong learners. Sheikh Abdullah bin Bayya, one of the greatest living scholars today, he studied until he was, he studied from the time he was about 4 years old until the time he was 21, every day, 5 to 6 days a week, 10, 15 hours a day, pure study with his father and the other teachers. He memorized 10 qira'at of Quran. He memorized all of the dawaween of the pre-Islamic Arabs. He learned all of these texts in Arabic grammar and learned the Alfiya, the Ihmirar, another 1,000 lines after the Alfiya. He studied the Kafiya. He studied the Mukhtasar Khalil, memorized the whole mashhur of the Madhab of Imam Malik. Wallahi, when you see him with his piety and the way he addresses these issues, Allahu A'lam. I've heard him many times say, Allah knows best. This is the best I can do. And I've asked him about a hadith. He said, it's not in the 6 collections. This is a level. And then we have people saying, who is Sheikh Abdullah bin Bayya? Who is he? Who are these dwarfs? Really, who are, with no offense to physical dwarfs. I'm talking about intellectual dwarfs. Physical dwarfs, that's not a problem. You know, that's the way Allah created them. But an intellectual dwarf, you created yourself. Allah gave you the ability to expand your mind. If your mind is not expanded, you are to blame. But knowledge comes with patience, comes with learning. They're pushing me off quick, so I'm going to be getting out of here.